Welcome back to another episode of Superhero News. We are here to bring you the latest news, previews, and reviews of some of our favorite and most anticipated upcoming superhero movies.
I like that enthusiasm.
Hector always scares me when he starts doing those things.
Hand motion.
Shooting webs.
Things.
My name is Adam Hladek.
I just cheers.
And I'm joined here with Hector Navarro.
Hi, I'm Hector.
And Agustin Rios.
And I'm drinking beer.
Cheers.
So, we got the first teaser trailer for Batman vs. Superman last week. And we got, or at least I got to go to the IMAX screening to see the extra 6 seconds.
Cool.
And on top of that, Zack Snyder released a brand new image of the Bat suit inside of the Batcave. What did you guys think of this photo? We got a glimpse of it in the trailer, but now we got the full image. What do you guys think of it?
What are you talking about? What photo? I don't know if I saw it. I just saw the video that we looked at earlier. I'm such an...
The
photo.
It's sort of an expansion on what they showed in the trailer.
Exactly.
I think it's great.
The lighting on it is fantastic. It's made to look mean, like I said in the video. It looks mean. It looks menacing. I think it looks... Honestly, this is my favorite Batman costume so far. On screen, it's my favorite one.
Yeah, and it's so funny because like I always feel like, oh, yeah, this suit's good. This suit's good. Every time there's a new actor, we feel like the suit's good. And then this one, I'm like, this is probably the closest thing we'll ever get to a comic book Batman suit. It's like you were saying, it's a very healthy blend of The Dark Knight Returns and Jim Lee's current rendition of Batman.
Yes, totally. It just reminds me of Batman Hush, which might be my favorite sort of modern Batman comic. Outside of The Dark Knight Returns, which is kind of like outside of time and space because it takes place in the future and stuff. But what I love is it's like it's got the black on gray.
Yeah, and finally.
Yeah, the original from the first 89 Batman movie up to now, it's always been like Batman will only operate in the real world if he's all black.
Right.
And comic book fans have been like, let's try to get that gray in there. We love the gray, and it's
the
cool.
Gray's awesome.
So cool.
What I like about this, I think the reason why it looks so mean is if you look at the shape of the head, it looks like a bulldog or a pit bull with its ears docked.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. You know how those fighting pit bulls have their ears docked? They have little tiny ears? Look at the shape of that head. It looks just like that.
And I mean, even the detail in the suit, you look at it like, it has all the cracks. We found out in the video that they released from the Warner Brothers tour, we found out that he's got steel knuckles, he's got steel-toed boots, he's got, I think the guards are also made out of steel, so he's a very weaponized Batman.
He's ready to kick some ass.
Yeah.
To the fullest.
Even though he almost looks stripped down and more like the comic book version, which looks just like gray spandex.
Right. Yeah.
This is funny that this is the most weaponized, like you said, and yet it looks simpler than something Christian Bale would wear with all the armor.
His was very tactical.
Very tactical.
Cool.
Speaking of the video, what did you guys think? We got to see, obviously, we saw more of the bat suit, more of the texture. We got to see a little bit more of the Wonder Woman suit. We found out she's going to have a shield, a sword. She's going to have the lasso. And then they also showed a little bit more of the Batmobile. What did you guys think of that?
I think it's great. I think that I would like an explanation as to why there's a machine gun turret on the front of the Batmobile.
He needs to knock some walls down, dude.
What, knock some walls down?
Yeah,
fine. I know that like the Batpod in the previous movies also had like a rocket launcher.
Yeah.
And it wasn't...
I think every Batmobile has pretty much had weapons, right?
Sure. Except that they're usually not lethal except for in the first few Tim Burton movies where Batman clearly kills a bunch of dudes and like doesn't give a shit. But and then Catwoman used it to kill Bane. But I would like something about... Batman's point of view on that in this film.
Whether he kills or doesn't kill, putting machine guns in.
Sure. If you said knock down walls, he knocks down walls.
Right.
That's fine.
Yeah. I mean, we get a glimpse in the trailer where he's like shooting things out of the Batwing. That was pretty.
Dude, he's knocking some shit out in the Batwing.
I think in this interpretation, Batman is so seasoned that at this point, he's just like, I'm just going to get the job done. I don't care what it takes.
Yeah. Listen, but I think it's also very easy to, in these movies, explain away. Like Batman doing incredible action, but being like, you know, like no one got hurt. Like it's so easy.
Right.
It's so, you know, he didn't kill anybody. It's so easy to do that. So
We found out last week that Michelle McLaren was leaving Wonder Woman due to creative differences.
It's a bummer.
Which we got a little bit of an update as to why she was leaving for reals. Yeah. We found out that she had a little bit of a different vision of Wonder Woman than Warner Brothers did.
Yeah.
She wanted to make an origin movie that was a little bit more in the vein of Braveheart, so a little more action, and Warner Brothers was looking for something that was a bit more character-driven and didn't rely so much on action.
That's
so
weird to me.
I think, the one little thing is we don't know the details. So we know that Michelle McLaren comes from television, and the idea of doing a movie was a bit overwhelming for her because there's so much more that is involved. So I don't know. I kind of understand why they parted ways, and it relieves me a little bit to know that they parted ways because I would rather them find someone who felt like they could do the movie than to have someone go in that's not confident.
Yes and no. I can understand that. I feel like maybe she wasn't necessarily overwhelmed, but with TV production, there's just a much quicker timeline.
Yeah.
They
yeah,
get shit quick. Done so yeah. quickly. And mm-hmm, with movies, mm-hmm. there's a lot of stalling mm-hmm. and there's a mm-hmm. lot more cooks in the kitchen, yeah. movie mm-hmm. producers. It's, you know, that have their hands in the pot, and that can be very frustrating. I know one of my favorite right. directors who came from the world of animation, Andrew Stanton, when he did live action with John Carter of Mars, there was a lot of him bringing his animation version of directing a movie mm-hmm. to live action. And people were like, whoa, what are you doing? He's like, this is how I direct a movie. And they're like, mm-hmm. well, it's different for live action. Right, and that's why people right. thought that he went over budget so much and went back and did reshoots because he mm-hmm. planned to do reshoots in the same way for an animated movie. You do like, you know, retakes, notes,
yeah.
retakes.
Yeah, you do notes, client
so
notes.
So coming from whatever. One world to another can absolutely be difficult. I also find it really weird that a movie studio didn't want an action-heavy origin movie, because that seems like a no-brainer. Mm-hmm. And there's been rumors that this version of Wonder Woman is much like Thor, has been around for a long time. Mm-hmm. And if mm-hmm. when they're using the word Braveheart, I'm like, well, does that mean like it's an old school, like there's going to be like horses and, you know,
it makes, sandals it makes, and swords.
Right, sandals and swords. Yeah. It makes me think of 300. It makes me think mm-hmm. of, you know, the mm-hmm. Wonder Woman animated movie where the opening of that, the direct-to-video that came out in 2009, mm-hmm. awesome if you haven't checked it out, where the opening was like in ancient Greece and they sort of set up the world and mm-hmm. it's just like mm-hmm. straight action.
Yeah.
And then they explain the origin of Diana, you know, the princess of Themyscira
yeah.
and how she came to be in that world. I just, it's weird to me that a movie studio would use terms like, we want a character-driven story that's less heavy in action. To me, that sounds
I don't
like,
get that. Yeah.
We don't want to spend as much money on big action stuff. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We want to, you know, we want to save that for Batman and Superman and the big heroes, and we want to save money with this Wonder Woman movie. I'm like don't a cop do out. That.
Yeah.
It, for me, it yeah. does feel like a cop out. But again, we out. Don't know what the story is. We don't know what the behind the scenes of it is. Mm-hmm. Maybe mm-hmm. there's differences in how they even want to approach her origin. Maybe Michelle McLaren wanted her to be like this ancient being that's been around for thousands of mm-hmm. years, and maybe Warner Brothers was like, you know, we just want to make it so that she's modern. Can we do a movie mm-hmm. set in modern times? Mm-hmm. And she's like, well, I want to do this big action. You know, swords and sandals.
She's like,
thing.
She wants to do like a classic Ben-Hur type. You
exactly.
Know, like,
we don't know until the movie comes out, and then yeah, they'll be yeah. maybe comfortable with talking about it. Like, we don't know exactly why they split, and how Edgar Wright's version of Ant-Man mm-hmm. and what mm-hmm. he wanted to do is different from whatever Marvel wanted to do and fit in their machine.
Right.
We don't
Another
know.
Another thing that I wanted to touch on, too, just because I've been working my ass off, the workload is very different, you know? I haven't had a day off in 3 weeks.
Yeah.
I've been working weekends, yeah. working wow. 10, 12-hour days.
Yeah.
It's tough, dude. Not everybody's cut out to work on a movie production. It's
true. I mean, Joss like Whedon's stage, done with you know? Marvel because he did these two huge movies for them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And he wants to go do other stuff. Yeah. Understandably, he hasn't right. had a day
Adam,
off.
You've been working long hours. I've been trying to finish up this TV show that we're working on.
Right.
So it's long and it's yeah. really not cut out for everybody, especially people who are coming from smaller productions who are just like, yeah, you know, we work a few hours. That plays with your mind. I felt like my eyeballs were going to explode yesterday.
Wow.
Because I was working so damn much, yeah. you know? It's just, it depends on where you're at mentally and if you're ready for that kind of a workload. Yeah. And right. not everybody is.
Yeah.
But anyways, enough technical jargon.
Well, so they did actually sign on a new director, only 2 days after we reported that Michelle McLaren had left the project, mm-hmm. they got Patty Jenkins, who originally was signed up to direct Thor the Dark World before she was right. replaced by Alan Taylor.
Right.
So, I don't know. I mean, to me, it seems like a good fit. Obviously, Marvel saw something in her sure. in Thor. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so, it kind of makes sense that they would get her to do yeah. a Wonder Woman movie.
Yeah.
yeah
because the characters are very similar in terms of their what type of character they are.
Before Michelle McLaren even left, Or right after she left, but before they got Patty Jenkins, mm-hmm. people
What's
people
happening?
Were what? Already speculating you're that drunk. Marvel was going to snag her. Uh-huh. They were going to snag McLaren and be like, now you're directing Captain Marvel for uh-huh. us. Mm-hmm. And it's funny that instead of that happening, DC Warner Brothers snagged Patty Jenkins, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. who was supposed to be the director of Thor 2.
Right.
You know, it's small circles. It's all the same sort
yeah,
of
it's all the
talent
same
that they're pulling from. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I think that's really interesting. Will Michelle McLaren eventually direct another superhero movie mm-hmm. for Marvel? Maybe. I don't know. But Patty Jenkins, yeah, another TV director, Entourage, Arrested Development, The Killing.
But she directed Monster, which yeah. got
oh, that's right.
Charlize
oh,
Theron the Oscar.
Oh. Yeah, she did. She directed the movie.
Oh, well, so that's some
go.
Street cred.
That gives Absolutely. It a little bit more cred.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So moving on, we got a little bit of casting news again for Suicide Squad. I feel like This is like one of those movies where literally everybody in Hollywood is going to be in this movie.
Yeah, a bunch of people are in this movie.
we don't know who this actor is playing, but they've cast Common in the movie.
Yep.
Who do you guys think that he could be playing? There's rumors running around of different characters, but who do you guys think? I mean, well, it's really hard to say.
It's really difficult to say, dude. At this point, they're being so tight-lipped that you can't really speculate unless Hector has some secret gems of knowledge.
I honestly
to
don't,
drop on
because the Suicide Squad world is such an obscure world, even in the world of DC Comics. Yeah. There's only been a few iterations of these characters, and all the characters are always like C and D level supervillains that go and get put on these suicide missions, which is great. That's part of the appeal of Suicide Squad.
That's what is the Suicide
Squad. The only thing I'm thinking, and I really hope this isn't the case because I don't think Common is right for this role, even though I love this character, is John Stewart, a.k.a. Green Lantern.
No way. Now, really? You really think he would be the Green Lantern?
Not Green Lantern, but John Stewart before he becomes Green Lantern to sort of plant that seed. Because John Stewart's a military guy.
With this. Of course. They're not going to cast him as John Stewart and then not have him as John Stewart in the
rest
of the
movies. Right. No, I know. But I mean, listen, they cast Terrence Howard as James Rhodes in Iron Man and then didn't use
Terrence
Howard.
Yeah, but he quit on purpose. Like, he quit.
He was let go because apparently he was difficult to work with. Well, that's a whole other thing.
Well,
that's another thing, too, you know?
Yeah,
that's a whole other thing.
Common is an awesome dude. Like, he's like one of the most humble, nicest guys that you could ever talk to.
Absolutely. Do I think he's right for John Stewart? No. But do I want John Stewart to be the Green Lantern in the Justice League movie? Absolutely. So I don't know who he could be. He's probably not playing John Stewart. I kind of doubt it. He's probably
Some people are
not
speculating
playing...
Black Manta or
that would be
Tiger.
Awesome.
Black Manta.
Black Manta would be sick, dude. Black Manta would be sick. And then he could show up in
awesome.
Jason Momoa's Aquaman.
The only thing with casting, with having him playing Black Manta is where does Black Manta fit into the Suicide Squad? Like, is he...
I think he's been on the Suicide Squad before. I mean, listen, Black Manta
fits because...
Oh,
that's true. He has been.
Because, again, this version of the Suicide Squad exists in a world where there's already been super villains.
Right.
And especially a lot of Batman villains. It's an easy thing to be like, here is a, you know, a pirate terrorist named Black Manta,
I mean,
who has like, you know, commandeered ships on the seven seas, and we put him into this, like, you know, supervillain prison because he's got like this really cool suit and whatever.
Right.
And maybe he hasn't even met Aquaman yet, or maybe he has, because we don't know how long Aquaman's been around.
Aquaman's also going to need to have a villain, so Black Manta.
There you
would
go, built-in villain. Okay, awesome, this movie's just finding all the villains just to, like, you know, plant the seeds so that it's like, you know,
very,
when the heroes
I'm
get
very,
their own movie, it's like, oh, remember so and so from Suicide Squad? Done. There's your bad guy.
I'm kind of skeptical though, because this is reminding me of Gotham at this point. They're trying to pack so many people into this movie, trying to set up something else, that I'm afraid that this thing is going to be terrible. Not giving characters enough room to breathe is a killer.
Unless a lot of it takes place in Arkham and all these characters are just kind of cameos.
Exactly. They could easily be cameos.
Yeah, exactly. We don't know what their level of involvement is going to be.
Yeah.
But to me, it casts a little bit of shadow of doubt in my head because it's just a lot of people at this point. It's just too many people. You only have roughly 2 hours to tell the story. It's going to be a lot.
We better like Deadshot, Harley Quinn,
exactly,
like the main characters of Suicide Squad.
They better really kill it with
but
those characters.
Common's cool though, dude.
He's an awesome guy. Yeah. I mean, if he's excited about this, maybe I'll get excited about this.
Here's some casting that I'm very excited about, but I don't have enough knowledge because we're talking about a lot of young actors that I'm not that familiar with their work. No. The five potential actors in the running for Peter Parker Spider-Man. Let's go through them. They are Tom Holland, Asa Butterfield, Liam James, Nat Wolff, and Timothy Chalamet. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Chalamet. It's French.
Guys that are all young kids. They're all like 18-ish around there. Mm-hmm. The one I'm familiar with is Asa Butterfield, who was in Ender's Game and Hugo, who's a British guy. And I'm kind of hoping they don't get a British guy to play Peter Parker. As much as I loved Andrew Garfield, I thought he was great. And mainly my thing about Asa Butterfield is that, like, saw him in both of those movies, and those roles were not the funniest, but he did not come across to me as a young kid who could quip it up. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Who's got that funny, like,
smart-ass. That Spider-Man charm.
He's just a really good actor and, like, very charming and, like, almost, like, has, like, good manners. He's, like, a nice, young, gentlemanly British kid.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I want that quippy, you know. So, again, really none of these actors. We looked them up. Tom Holland was in The Impossible, and Liam James was from Interstellar.
James was on The Way Back.
The Way Back.
Nat Wolff was in Fault in Our Stars and Paper Towns that's coming out. Timothy Chalamet was in Interstellar.
Sorry,
and Asa Butterfield is obviously in Hugo and stuff.
You know, apparently they're all good actors. They all are probably good actors. I just really hope my main thing for this role is that I want them to get a kid who's just super funny. That's key to me.
Yeah,
that is key.
Yeah.
Even almost more so than like being a good actor. than being somebody that can make me cry, because we've had the versions of Peter Parker that have been sensitive and sort of made us cry before. I want a really funny kid. When we get to his own movie later, then we can explore that emotional stuff. But what do you guys think?
I mean, out of all these choices, I think I know Asa Butterfield the most, and I've only seen him in Hugo. I haven't seen The Impossible. I saw Interstellar, but Timothy Chalamet doesn't have a big role, so it's really hard to judge. And I didn't see Fault in Our Stars or Paper Towns, which hasn't come out yet, I don't think. So it's really, really hard to say. If I was going just based on looks, I think we kind of agree that the two actors that we probably would pick just based on looks would be Tom Holland and Liam James. Yeah.
Because they're like 5'6", 5'7".
Yeah, and they're 18 years old. So it's tough. And, you know, we don't know how accurate this list is. There could be more actors. There could be only less actors. So it's tough to say. But based on looks alone, those are the two actors that I would go with. But I would have to honestly sit down and watch more of their movies to really make a decision.
Right. And they're so greenhorned right now that there's not a lot you can base your decision off of. What I want to say is that Hector was right when we called that... when we had that Spider-Man episode.
Oh, absolutely. You should go back and check it
out. Hector called that they were going to, from a source, that they were casting a young kid.
Of course,
Yes, but what I want to say about these guys is that these guys are all young people.
Yeah.
There's no way that we can officially say, this guy's right for Spider-Man, this guy's right.
Sure.
It's really, like you were saying, all based on looks at this point.
Right.
So these kids are probably all giving different performances. We don't know what they're like. We don't know their personalities.
Yeah, what their tests
and at this
are
point,
like.
it's a coin toss as to whoever is going to be Peter Parker and Spider-Man. There's no way to tell. Just like, what's his name from Sixth Sense?
Yeah.
What's his name?
Haley Joel Osment.
Yeah. Look at him as an adult, dude. It looks like his face never grew up. Like, his face is just, like, squinched in the middle of his giant head.
What a weird thing to bring up, but you're right.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, though, like, these kids are going to grow into Spider-Man.
Yeah.
And they're going to use them for the next 10 years.
And plus, we don't know exactly what Marvel's... I mean, we have an idea of what Marvel's take of Spider-Man is going to be.
Right.
But we don't know the exact context and the exact story.
Yeah.
So that can also really shift based on the performance of every actor.
It just depends. Like, what if nobody likes this kid particularly as Spider-Man, but the movie's great?
Right.
Sure. You know?
Maybe
are they
going
to recast? Ask them what are they
gonna
do?
Keep the same. Yeah.
What if his face grows like Haley Joel Osment, you know, and nobody likes his face as an adult?
Who knows, dude? What if it's like
these kids are young?
What if it's like Boyhood and he grows up to be a bad actor?
What if mid what if mid second Spider-Man movie he decides he's transgender or something like that? You know, you don't know.
What if instead of doing live action they just do an animated Spider-Man?
Well, hey, that's an excellent transition. What if you mean it's gonna happen?
True.
So, guys, I've got good news and bad news. Actually, it's mostly bad news. here's why. I'll explain. So, Sony,
I'm excited. I don't know why you're not
Sony,
excited.
I'm excited about some stuff. Sony announced that they are pursuing Phil Lord and Chris Miller to help them to develop an animated Spider-Man movie that's going to be separate from any live-action Spider-Man films that's being done by Marvel Studios and Sony together. And they're doing an animated Spider-Man movie on their own. To just be released in theaters in 2018, I believe, is what they're doing.
Yeah, I think so.
Is what they're saying. So, yeah, the Lego movie directors, Lord and Miller, who I think are some of the most talented people in Vegas.
It was announced in Hollywood.
Some of the most talented guys. So that is what I'm excited about, because they're great writers and they're super funny. But I am having a really tough time figuring out why this movie deserves to exist. I feel like this is Sony saying, hey, listen, the producers of The Amazing Spider-Man 2, Avi Arad and Matt Tolmek, we're basically firing you guys, and you're not allowed to have any say in the next Spider-Man live-action film, and we're having Kevin Feige and Marvel Studios help us with this, but we're not technically firing you because you guys are producers that has made us billions of dollars, and that would look bad and blah, 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 blah. So here's what you're going to be working on. Here's a Spider-Man project that you guys are doing. And that still kind of bums me out, because I'm like, cool, you just got the producers that really muddled an Amazing Spider-Man 2 movie, and now you're going to have them maybe muddle an animated film. And my other problem with an animated movie working coexisting with a live-action movie is that it just undercuts whatever Marvel Studios is trying to do. I racked my brain, I couldn't think of a worthy Spider-Man story that they could do in an animated version that
hasn't been done yet.
It hasn't been done yet, like in an animated format, in a TV show or whatever, or in a live action thing that like Marvel Studios couldn't do immediately or later on down the line. Like, I'm just having a really tough time with this.
That's kind of how I feel. I don't really understand what the point is of doing an animated Spider-Man movie simultaneously with doing Marvel's Spider-Man.
Money. Just to make money.
But it's... I mean, they have talent. Lord and Miller are really talented guys. And the other questionable thing is, they're not confirmed, but they're being rumored to be developing Flash at Warner Brothers. So it's like, how do those timelines work together? Because they're going to write and produce this. They're not going to direct it, per se, but I mean, they could end up directing it. But yeah, I don't understand what the point is of doing this movie. Is this Sony's way of making up for what they did and trying to redevelop the entire thing?
No. Dude, one point, money.
Yeah.
Money is the only reason they're doing this.
They still have the rights to
Spider-Man. Money is the only reason they're still doing those DC animated movies as well.
No, but I agree. But I think, like, the audience knows how Sony screwed up Spider-Man.
Now
they're going animated. So it's like, is the audience really going to be receptive to this movie?
Listen to the audience that's going to watch this movie. Kids.
Yeah.
People under 15 are going to watch this movie. Kids. They're going to watch the movie no matter what. Their parents are going to drag them to watch
Star Wars, The Clone Wars.
That's all it is, dude. You've seen those DC animated movies. Mm-hmm. They don't make money. They keep making them because kids love them and they're
But they're also not theatrical.
It doesn't matter, dude. It does not matter. They're getting a whole new generation of kids hooked on Spider-Man is what they're doing.
All right. So just real quick, this is a real cool, happy thing. Oscar Isaac, who's playing Apocalypse, a.k.a. En Sabanur, a.k.a. the first one.
From what other names does he have?
That's it. He probably has more, but in
Jedi,
X-Men,
Jedi Apocalypse. On the streets, Sith in the sheets.
That's what's up. That's what's up. X-Wing pilot in the streets. I don't know what else in the sheets. He has been talking about the approach to playing Apocalypse, and it sounds really, really cool. He's talking about how he's going to be recruiting his four horsemen of the apocalypse and how his character appeals to each one of them and kind of gives him a different power and kind of everything just lines up with like, cool, we're going to get Angel in this movie, but Archangel with metal wings and be evil. Mm-hmm. And we're going to get so-and-so and he's going to power them up and they're going to be, you know, famine and pestilence and death and war. It's going to be sick. And then he talked about the approach for like his character and how it's like a biblical apocalypse. Mm-hmm. Like that's what he's bringing to this. Mm-hmm. This character wakes up in 1983. He's an ancient character, but he wakes up in the year 1983 and he's like, how did we get to this point? Everyone is so weak. Mm-hmm. It just fits in line with the character so well. Mm-hmm. I'm so excited about his enthusiasm. I think it's great. What do you guys think about Oscar Isaac's take on
Apocalypse? I like the fact that Oscar Isaac definitely shows that he is a comic book guy.
He's a fan.
Yeah.
He's a fan.
And it's funny. Cool. Someone actually made a comment that you look like Oscar Isaac.
Oh, yeah. Somebody commented.
And it's funny. As soon as I said that and I looked at you, I'm like, this is what he kind of looked like at the Star Wars panel.
I Googled him. Yeah, baby. You know, and
that's because it sounds like somebody's trying to get inside Llewellyn Davis. You know what I'm saying?
Gross.
Keep that joke. Keep
gross
that
nasty.
Gross. Good joke.
But yeah, I mean, I'm excited to see this character, and he seems like he's a very, very dedicated actor. I mean, you inside Llewellyn Davis, Ex Machina, Star Wars, all these movies that he's doing.
He's the best part of Sucker Punch.
Yeah. Oh, he's in Sucker Punch.
Yeah.
Was he? I didn't know that.
That movie was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whatever. But yeah, I'm super excited to see what they do with this character. You know, this is gonna really be my entry point to Apocalypse
because
I'm not too familiar with them. Yeah, I never read X-Men as a kid.
Man.
Yeah. A big deal. I read DC stuff. Remember?
I love and I hate Apocalypse.
I know.
It's crazy.
He's the real deal.
He scares me. Like Apocalypse.
He can be really silly.
Truly terrifying. Yeah, he can be terrifying. Yeah. I mean, he can be silly, but he's. He pretty much has unlimited powers. He can do whatever he wants.
Well, yeah, just from that one clip from Days of Future Past, you get an idea of how ridiculously powerful he can be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Lifting a pyramid.
I like this. It seems like he's very dedicated to this role. And it fills me with confidence when people are dedicated to this role or roles that they do because they like what they're doing, essentially. And that's what I like to see. I like people who are enthusiastic because their enthusiasm eventually rubs off on me.
Totally. Yeah.
You know, and it rubs off on everybody else. You can tell when people enjoy their craft or whatever they're doing at the point.
When you have something like that, you have something like Hugh Jackman playing Wolverine or Robert Downey Jr. playing Iron Man. These are actors that love the characters, and that's a sort of passion and good work that you
Even
get out
of. Even though I don't agree with...
He loves the role.
With Hugh Jackman. Yeah. He loves the role. He does it well.
You don't agree with the casting of Hugh Jackman.
Exactly.
Let's clarify. Okay,
I don't
agree.
I've said this a billion times.
I know.
Anyways.
So, awesome.
Let's move on to the next one.
Cool.
We have a new Fantastic Four trailer out.
Yes. And they gave us a poster with it.
Well, they gave us...
That's what we're looking at.
The poster. Sorry. There's a new poster, not a trailer.
Mm-hmm.
So this poster shows the thing in the background looking awesome. We got the three other characters, Susan Storm, we got Richard Reeds, and then we got Johnny Storm.
Reed Richards.
Didn't you just read Ultimate Fantastic Four?
I did. I haven't.
How many of those beers have you had?
I'm dyslexic,
to
you
be
guys.
Fair,
and I'm two beers down.
To be fair, both of his names are both first names.
Yeah.
It's very exactly.
Like, kind of like Oscar Isaac.
Reed Richards.
Exactly.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Kill me now.
No, you know Reed. You know Reed.
I know Reed. Anyways, this poster's looking pretty great. It's still kind of a drop in the bucket at this point. I kind of want to see the Thing more in action.
Right.
Just because we did see a little bit of snippets of him.
Mm-hmm.
But at this point, I'm more curious about the story. This poster kind of doesn't really do it for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, this poster is very plain. Yeah. It's like, mm-hmm. it's four characters standing in front of a city.
Yeah.
And they look yeah. cool.
Yeah.
It's very photoshopped.
Yeah.
Susan very. Storm will, of course, have to show off every curve in her body.
Mm.
And it's
thumbs
like,
down.
I
don't like it. I really,
and I know I've said this before, I really miss the old school posters that are hand-drawn and yeah. crafted by artists. Mm-hmm. I'm not really
well,
into
I
the
mean,
Photoshop
an
thing.
An artist did do this.
Of course.
But it's different.
But a lot of yeah. this, mm-hmm. like these new modern posters, a lot of them are dictated and they're always reviewed and revised by studio heads
you
and
have
all these
like
things.
10
it's like
people looking at
exactly.
This
it's not like
out.
Drew
yeah.
Struzan who draws something and he shows and they're like, okay, this looks good. Maybe do this, and then
dude,
they draw it, and it's like, here you go.
Nobody critiques Drew Struzan.
Yeah, you
nobody
know, it's
critiques,
like, just,
like, just
let the
Drew
artist
Struzan
do the thing.
Drew Struzan gives you a poster, and that's what you
exactly.
get.
Exactly.
Yeah. And it's
and that's
amazing.
What that's what I miss. And, I mean, the poster's fine. You get to see all the characters, and you get to see a little glimpse of their powers,
sure.
except for Reed Richards. I don't know why they didn't do anything with him.
Because it would look weird, because this is a poster of characters just standing there.
The kids
yeah.
stretching, and everybody's, yeah.
Yeah. It's very generic. There's two main things that bug me. Number one is we don't see the Thing's eyes. They're, like, mm-hmm. shrouded in shadow.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing is that, like we talked about, Sue is the one that's turned to the side and looking at the other, at Reed, basically, at Miles Teller,
mm-hmm.
as if she loves him and whatever, but he gets mm-hmm. to look straight at the camera and be a badass, and so does Johnny. And this poster could have been easily just as good if Kate Mara's Sue Storm was also just looking straight at us.
Right.
Just, you know what I mean?
Just the
like,
exact same pose,
boom, boom, boom,
just looking at the camera.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a, and that's a thing that leads me to think about how there's movie studio heads that be like, well, we got to show that she's like the sexy Caucasian
the
woman.
How are they going to know
gonna
if she's
know?
A woman?
We got to turn her to the side
yeah.
so she can show her boobs and her butt at
yeah.
the same time. Let's see the boobs and her butt. It's like, guys, you already casted her instead of a black actress.
Yeah.
Like, we know that you want your hot white female on there with blonde hair blowing in the wind. Like this is a freaking Carl's Jr. commercial.
We get it, dude.
Okay.
So get that shit.
So it's, that's just a bit of a bummer. So no. whatever. The poster's fine, but the trailers have been awesome.
Yeah, the trailers have been fantastic. Watch those trailers.
I completely agree.
Forget
different
this.
People.
Next bit of news we have is Daredevil has been signed
yes.
on for season
yes.
two.
Yes.
Season two. So I'm going to admit, I'm only halfway through season one.
Yeah, you are, you bastard.
Andale, cabrón.
We're
going to
do some Daredevil shit later.
Hey, andale.
Call me, I am a puto for not
no,
watching this
I said apúrate, güey.
No, well, I'm a puto too
okay,
for not watching this shit.
Well, as long as we agree on something.
I've been busy, okay? But either way, I'm only halfway through it. But
yeah.
it doesn't surprise me that they've been signed on for a season two. This show already is fantastic.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about the show too much
sure,
because
sure.
we have our special
But we
episode
can talk about the
up,
reaction, which
yes.
is that it has been critically very well received.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah.
And we will never understand the mysteries of Netflix's ratings. Like, they
no.
never release
no.
their rating information. But we can just assume it's been crushing it because
of
yeah.
everyone's been talking.
All they have
about
is a star rating, but this show I think is 5 out of 5 or 4 out of 5.
Yeah, it's like
well,
four
it's very high.
It's you know yeah,
yeah
exactly.
Yeah.
So we don't know how all those Netflix algorithms work,
right.
mm-hmm.
but it does not surprise us that they were probably waiting for like critical reaction to see how well it did with the critics. They were waiting to see like them promoting Daredevil, how many new subscribers they got
mm-hmm.
to Netflix
right.
as a whole.
Yeah, just
if,
to
right.
I know a few
just
people that
this.
Signed up to Netflix just to watch this.
Wow.
Yeah.
So all of
yeah.
that coupled with like how many people watched it as soon as we put it on, how many people
mm-hmm.
have been marathoning it, how many, you know,
yeah.
all that stuff, like, great, we got to
yeah, they
get
all
two.
Those numbers, and they go and they review them, and they say, well,
so
it's definitely worth it, and
killed it,
and
so
because,
excited. Killed it, bro.
Because of how good the first season was,
yeah.
they now slated this to premiere the same time next year,
no,
2016,
yeah. Yeah.
so they're going to start shooting the second season sometime at the end of,
here's,
sometimes close
here's
to
the other thing,
yeah.
though,
soon.
Is that the showrunners are not going to be working on the
Stephen
show.
DeKnight Stephen DeKnight and Drew Goddard.
Which is
yeah.
a huge bummer because they did a fantastic job with season
yeah.
one. That it's disappointing to say the least, but hopefully they get all the main players back.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. I know that
I
all
think
the
so.
Actors
I think
would
they
be
will.
Right.
I think
absolutely.
They will.
I think
yeah.
Vincent D'Onofrio is going to probably coming back as Kingpin. You know, he went on record. Charlie Cox as Daredevil went on record saying
mm-hmm.
like, yeah, we're going to come back if they ask us.
Yeah.
So
well, didn't you interview them? Hector?
Yes, I did.
oh,
I
shit.
Asked them, and they
watch
said
those
yeah.
videos too.
So yeah, and yeah.
I mean, it's all good news, especially
yeah.
because
it's all very good news.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has been received okay. Agent Carter was received pretty well,
mm-hmm.
but this definitely was received the best out of any Marvel television
yeah,
show.
Absolutely,
and I think
I think it's been one of the biggest Netflix shows out in general.
Most likely,
you know?
Yeah.
Netflix
yeah.
has had some killer shows
yeah.
too.
Yeah,
that's the
and
thing.
I think
sure.
it's very. I think it. it's great that it's doing so well, and I think it's going to open the floodgates for other characters. Maybe Charlie Cox has mentioned he'd love to see the Punisher. He'd love to see Elektra. He'd love to see Bullseye on the show. So who knows? Like, there's a lot of possibilities with season two.
This really makes me look forward to anything that they're going to be doing in the future. Man. Defenders, as whatever they're bringing on, I'm down for it.
Yeah,
you know, I will watch
it. So great.
Anyways, enough of that. Let's talk about one of the topics that I've been interested in about for a while. Sony Pictures and Valiant have just announced a 5-picture deal, including Bloodshot and Harbinger. Now, I have not read those comics yet, but I did a little bit of research about the people that are moving over. There's Marvel writers that are moving over to Valiant talking about how these stories are so great, and it's filling me with confidence that these movies are going to be sort of, I don't want to say full on, but it's going to be a competition to Marvel.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, it's going to be, it's even those, you know, based in China, it's going to be something not done inside of the United States. It's going to be something that's going to throw major competition at Marvel and maybe even DC at this point. Absolutely. You know?
I have read one issue of Bloodshot and I freaking loved it. I thought it was great and it made me want to read the rest of Valiant. And I had people tell me, like comic book guys that I know tell me, like, hey, all the stuff that Valiant Comics have been doing as of late is so great because it feels like classic 90s comic books, but like done well. Mm-hmm. Like you take those crazy, over the top, outrageous ideas from the 90s where like Bloodshot and it's really just
that
90s.
Name. Yeah, yeah, like that name is just
and
like.
And they take this, they take that idea and they're like, well, what if it was really good? And they wrote like a great version of it. I was so into it. So I think that competition is always just going to make whoever is like sort of in power better because it's competition. Definitely. And then the same way that indie comic books, when the way that they work is they can always sort of push it a little bit further because they're indie, because they're trying to get your hard-earned dollar.
Yes, they're not trying Marvel to be family friendly. They're not trying to be PC.
They're just trying to tell good stories.
It's and if they take that approach with these indie movies, they'll technically be indie even though they're like Sony. Yeah. They take that same approach with these Sony films.
Sony Searchlight.
I think it's going to be really exciting, and it's going to it's just going to be better for everybody. Like
The only thing that I hope and pray is that Sony is only involved in a distribution level.
I hope so. I hope you're right.
I know that Valiant signed a multi-million-dollar deal with DMG, a Chinese production company, to produce the movies.
Cool.
So I'm really hoping that Sony is just involved in distribution and they don't try to put their hands on it because we all know what happened with Spider-Man.
Yeah.
But in terms of the movies themselves, I'm super excited.
Yeah.
Bloodshot and Harbinger are going to lead into Harbinger Wars, which I guess is a big crossover comic book event in the Valiant comics.
Pretty cool.
The directors of Bloodshot are going to be the same directors of John Wick, which...
That's awesome.
It's huge.
It was such a good movie. They've got it's Jeff Wadlow writing the script. Mm-hmm. They've got is it Straczynski or Brian Michael Bendis?
I think it's Straczynski.
They've got really top notch talent working on these movies.
You guys, man, people are coming over because they know quality. Oh, yeah. And I have a feeling these movies are gonna blow us out of the water.
Yeah, and I'm super excited. Yeah. And it's cool because I think Valiant just rebooted their comics.
They did
within the last year or so. So now's a perfect time to start reading all these comics.
Check that stuff out.
I mean, there's so many.
You can catch the first issues of Exo Man of War, of Bloodshot, of all these other characters that are great, apparently.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you can feel like you are in with the cool kids.
And you can definitely, like, I definitely could feel that people are really interested in these characters because at WonderCon, they had a booth. Valiant had a booth.
Yeah.
And it was swarmed with people.
That's great. Yeah?
Ever since the announcement, I think people have been really excited because they're characters that most people don't know.
Right.
But you've got great writers working on it. Now you've got great filmmakers working on it.
Yeah.
So there's a huge appeal to get a lot of people start reading these comics. And,
the exciting thing, too, is these characters don't have that sort of added pressure
that
a very famous character like a Batman or a Superman has.
Yeah.
It's like you hear like Bloodshot and you're like, ooh, what's that? And they could do whatever the hell they want.
They can, absolutely.
He could like love Hello Kitty and he could, you know, do whatever. Yeah. And
it sounds like Deadpool.
Well, I'm just saying, like an example.
They have a lot of free range. Yeah.
Just a few weeks ago, Bloodshot Reborn issue number 1 came out with like this new comic book series involved. Like, and I read that and I thought it was awesome.
Yeah.
Super stoked about it.
I'm really excited about this. I'm looking forward to this. I'm trying to finish up Fantastic Four and I'm trying to finish up other things that
are you excited about this as you are about our next topic?
I'm really excited about this but not about the next topic.
Why? What's our next topic?
Our next topic.
What is it?
We're talking Transformers.
Oh boo.
Yay, Transformers universe. So I don't know who came up with this, but somebody apparently thought...
An accountant.
Yeah, somebody looking at a bank account said that they're going to do a Transformers shared universe. Shared with what? Shared with bullshit. Because this is stupid. This is absolutely stupid. I hate these movies from the bottom of my heart. This needs to die. It needs to burn. It needs to stop. And we need to move along. We need to have somebody either reboot this or just stop in general.
My two cents is I would be fine with them doing a shared universe.
No.
If they would get rid of Michael Bay.
Yeah. No, not even Michael. Well, not even getting rid of Michael Bay at this point. They
need what I think that Paramount really needs to do, because they've got a key. They have a board or a trust or whatever the hell,
sure,
who's going to develop this. It's supposed to be Michael Bay, Steven Spielberg, Akiva Goldsman, and Lorenzo de Bonaventura. We've had movies from all four of these people, and they've all been terrible.
Past four movies,
I think the only movie I will give credit to is the first Transformers. Agreed. That's the most passable movie. Agreed. Out of all of them. Ugh. We saw Transformers 4. We slept through most of it, but that's besides the point. If they want to do Transformers, they need to focus on the Transformers. It's called Transformers. Don't have Shia LaBeouf. Don't have Mark Wahlberg. Get a director like Neil Blomkamp, who can tell the story, the origin story of the Transformers from a very realistic perspective through the eyes of the Transformers, and make us care about the Transformers.
You know what really bugs the crap out of me about this is that Paramount, in grabbing these Hasbro properties, which, let's be honest, Hasbro is a toy company and a board game company, only has two good properties that could be good movies, and they are Transformers and G.I. Joe.
Which not is probably Battle what the shared Ship. Universe is.
Yeah, but what bugs me the most is that when they were making their Transformers movie and they were making their G.I. Joe movies, they never once thought to cross them over because they're dum-dums, because they didn't have that sort of foresight to know that this is what movie audiences would eventually prefer. And that really bugs me. So when they're saying shared universe, it makes me want to say, you know what? Reboot the whole thing. Both of them across the board. What if they
made
what if they made
a shared universe, but reboot it,
like a new G.I. Joe movie, and at the end, after the credits, they tease a Cybertronian thing. And you're like, oh, cool. That's because G.I. Joe and Transformers have crossed over so many times in the comic books, and it's super fun and it's great.
I mean,
and those things can exist in the same world. This is just such a big bummer. Even when they sort of rebooted, soft rebooted the Transformers franchise with Mark Wahlberg with this fourth one.
It's not even a reboot. It's the same thing.
But when they did that, they did that. They didn't have the foresight to pull back into their three movies that already existed, because what my plan would have been is grab the Mexican kid from the second movie, the second Transformers movie. I know I've said this before, and use him as your sort of new trilogy, because he was doing basically Shia LaBeouf style stuff, interestingly, off to the side. And there you can have two different stories. Like they weren't smart enough to go back and pull Tyrese and Josh Duhamel, the army guys from the first few movies,
which were the characters that I actually thought were kind of fun.
They were fun. Yeah. It's like, why don't you just build a whole franchise around those two guys?
Why
They're
can't
great
they
actors.
Become G.I. Joe characters?
They were even based on G.I. Joe characters.
Exactly. That's what
but
I'm
they
saying.
Didn't, but they didn't have the balls to be we're going for it. This is Duke and,
The Rock.
Whatever. Yeah. this is Duke and Roadblock. They didn't do that.
Yeah.
So it really, really bugs me. Whenever I think of Paramount and Transformers, all I see is these guys have dollar signs in their eyes. That's it.
All it is,
and it
dude.
Bums me out. Even Spielberg, that's I'm like, Spielberg, come on, man.
And it sucks because Spielberg's name, honestly, is only on the poster of these movies. Spielberg doesn't do anything with these movies. He just contributes maybe his name. Yeah, that's it.
I think he had some say in the first film, and I think that he was able
to help develop it
and be like, this is what the story should be. It's about a boy in his first car.
Right.
And you're like, oh, that sounds great, Steven Spielberg.
That's
Are you going to direct this?
Very charming.
No, I'm good.
I'm actually just going to reap the benefits of it. And smoke my Cuban cigars.
Put my name on it. Put my name. It's fine. Yeah. I'm Steven Spielberg.
That's fine. I don't want to do anything ever again.
Come on,
so.
Spielberg.
Yeah,
I love you.
It's a bummer. I think they need to just reboot this whole thing. And I honestly haven't even been that big of a fan of the design of the Transformers. To me, they're way too complicated.
Yeah.
And they're way too just fake looking.
Yeah. That's just me, though. It's fine for them to be complicated. I thought that it worked in that first film because they would take 12 seconds to transform and it looked awesome. The first time they would do that stuff, and now they just pop into a robot.
Yeah, it's just they flip and then they're transformed. You don't care.
Reboot the thing, look at Transformers Prime, copy that. That cartoon show is brilliant and made me cry at the end. Just do that and try to mix in the G.I. Joe, and that's it.
Man, Transformers.
We have to end with that.
What a bummer.
Why do we end it on such a down?
I know, right?
Let's just have a dance party. to make ourselves feel better.
We need to have like a thing on like on Geek and Sundry when people subscribe that we can dance.
Yeah. And thank you once again to everybody who's subscribing.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you guys so much. We couldn't do this without you. So thank you.
If you tell us what you think, comment on the video below. If you agree with us, disagree with us, if you want us to talk about something else in the news we may have missed, let us know. Mm-hmm. Of course, subscribe, like the video, and share it. If you think you know somebody
on your territory, homie.
If there's a special geek in your life that you think would like this, send it to him. Show it to him. Yeah. It's good. That's what we do for.
Say hi.
So yeah, that's it.
In the meantime, you guys can follow us on Facebook, facebook.com/superheronews.com.
Where?
Twitter @superheronewscb. Uh-huh. And of course, our website run by Chris Bagley from batmannews.com.
Yeah. Thank you.
Superheronews.com. We'll see you guys in the next video.
Bye.
Bye.